Gotcha.
It is now the turn of an organizer of a future Olympic Games to share his thoughts and tell us more about the aims for a post-Games legacy in his city. So please welcome to the stage Tony Estanguet, President of Paris 2024. Let a few people who need a loo break go. We'll free up some seats for everyone standing at the back. Welcome. Tony, by the way, is the only French athlete to have won 3 gold medals at 3 different Olympic Games. A glass of wine for the first person to name his sport. Hands up. The keen hand in the black jumper at the back there. Yeah, no, I'm looking at you with the curly, beautiful curly hair. Canoe slalom, so.
More champion.
Oh no. So you owe her a glass of wine. A second glass for someone who can name the category. Canoe slalom category. It's a hand up over here, no? A room full of Olympic fans and no one can name the category. Tony. Tony. Oh, is that one of your slalom colleagues gone? C1, there you go. You owe them a drink. Yeah, Tony's definitely buying. We've just heard a very spirited debate about the economics of hosting an Olympic Games. It would be great to hear your immediate reaction to what you've heard. We're glad you haven't run away.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you very much for this opportunity for Paris 2024 to be associated to this moment. I think it was very interesting, the debate we just heard. For us, as a former bidding cities, we can say that the new norm has been really determining in the way that I think I wouldn't be here if at that time when Paris and France was questioning if it was a good idea or not to go back in this competition. At that time, the politicians in France were really questioning because we went through different tries in terms of having the games, and I think the way that the IOC came to us saying, okay, we want to change a little bit the way we want to organize the games from now, and we have a fantastic platform, the games, and we want to put this platform at the service of the cities. And this is completely different, because now we heard at that time that there is a flexibility coming with the product of the games. And if we are all here, I think we share the fact that sport can change lives. And that's why for us, why we decided to go and to run to host the games, because we were we are sure that for France, for Paris, it was a great opportunity to use the platform of the games to really make a change in our society. And that's why the new norm and the Agenda 2020 really had an impact on the fact that we decided to go and to bid for the games.
So the legacy that Paris was looking for, is looking for, isn't an infrastructure legacy. You've already got that in place. You have the venues in place. You're already on the map. You're Paris, for goodness sake. You're on the map. It's about social change.
What we appreciated at that time and with the new norm coming is the fact that the IOC came to us saying, okay, you have to tell us why we want to organize the games. And effectively, we could also have a good contact with previous organizing committees, looking at the best practices. And we had very interesting learnings. The first one was, be careful with the infrastructures, because it's really often where there are some problems in terms of budget. And at that time in France, people were questioning the idea of bidding because of the cost. And when we came with the project with 95% of existing venues or temporary venues, then it was a very good argument to demonstrate that those games will be different. The second argument coming with the new norm was the legacy. And at that time, we had to demonstrate to the AOC that the bidding phase will leave anyway a legacy. And that's why over the 2 years of the bidding phase, we put in place concrete programs in terms of education. We reached 2 million kids in schools where we could really implement a program to promote the Olympic and Paralympic values. And that was a very strong legacy of the bidding phase. Now we will continue because we hosted the right to organize the games. But we wanted to put ourselves in a situation that whatever the result of the bidding phase, we will leave a legacy. And the legacy starts even before the fact that you are elected as a host city. And that was really important for us.
Did you start to get nervous once other cities pulled out?
Of course. At that moment, again, in Europe, it was really questioned about the interest of bidding. And on our side, we decided at that time to change a little bit the strategy and to engage with the population. But engaging the population not in a way that we should ask the population yes or no. Engaging the population in a national consultation by co-creating the games with them, the project with them, and hearing from what they wanted to, how they believe that we should use the games for. And what we learned at that time is the fact that there is a need in this country to better use the values of sport in terms of education, in terms of inclusion, in terms of health. We know that 4 teenagers out of 5 don't practice enough physical activity. We know that the fact that you are sedentary in your life is the fourth source of mortality.
Do you think the games will have that impact? We just heard Andrew Zimbalist talk about how studies coming from Britain have said actually it's gone the other way, if anything. You know, watching people do sport hasn't made everyone else get off their sofas.
Yes, we are sure, because we completely changed the format and the strategy of Paris 2024 project. It's not anymore investing money, energy in building infrastructures. It's investing the energy in intangible legacy by putting in place, implementing programs to really develop the practice of sport in the country. And again, we did it during the bidding phase, and we will continue now as the organizing phase. And there is a space to really achieve a change in this regard.
Maybe culturally you're a bit more already set up to be fitter than the Brits. I mean, there are books about why French people don't get fat, so maybe the legacy of fitness will work better than it has in London. What are the benefits of hosting an Olympic Games? How has Paris already benefited from being a previous host?
Again, I think in our country, we really want to put sport in the heart of society in the way that the platform of the Games can be useful for everyone. Sport has changed my life. I've been an Olympian. I know the power of the Games. And I'm also convinced that sport can change lives of millions of people in my country. And that's something.
In what way can it change?
In the way that there are three parts, I think. The first part is in terms of celebration of the games. How we will imagine a new games edition with completely creative way to really propose, present, showcase the best of the athletes, the best of sport. And there is, again, a space to create with the AOC, with the international federations, a new way to showcase the best of sport. Not only focusing on infrastructures, but really in terms of sport presentation. So the first pillar is about celebration. And the celebration in Paris will be just amazing, because thanks to the international federations, thanks to the AOC, who are more open now to make some changes, because we will have competition at the foot of the Eiffel Tower, at the Château de Versailles, at Les Invalides, Grand Palais. So we really try to propose the best of France to organize the games. So the celebration will be unique. The second part is in terms of legacy, and how, again, how we will really make a change over the 6 years of the organizing phase to really put sport at the service of sport and make sure that, like us, like many of us in this room, because I know that there are many famous Olympians in the room, more people will have access to sport. And this is not the case today. So I think this is the great platform to really make a change on this one. And the last one is about engaging. How we will really engage a whole country with this positive project. This is fantastic. It's really what impressed me the most during the bidding phase. This is the project that you can federate politicians, private sector, trade unions, and in France sometimes it's not easy, but we manage it. But also the sport movement, the kids. So everyone is very excited at the moment to really be part of this unique project. And this is, there is no value about this. We spoke, we heard a lot about budget and cost of the games, but I can tell you how much the population now is excited by the idea of being part of welcoming the world and being part of, for a generation, this centenary games. The last time France has organized the games was one centenary ago, in 1924. So there is a big excitement at the moment in France.
So did Paris need this more than the IOC needed Paris to host this? Which way around is it?
I don't know what I think.
It sounds like you really, the country needs this come together.
Yeah, I'm sure
World Cup wasn't enough.
I'm sure France needs the games. I'm sure it will get a big impact for the country. I think also what is very interesting at the moment is the fact that the IOC is really in a position to put flexibility. And new norm is not just about cutting the cost. It's about how we will organize the games differently, how we will be more creative, how we will add value to the games, continue to add value to the games. Maybe by cutting some costs, but more specifically by really putting in place a high level of ambition. And this is what the games can carry, a message of enthusiasm. And we are very happy that all the stakeholders are united at the moment to deliver those games.
Paris will be the first games where the new norms fully kick into gear. How has it affected the planning? So where are we going to see those efficiency savings, and where are we going to see that flexibility? Are any venues, for example, outside Paris, or you know, where are we going to see that?
Yeah, we've been awarded the right to organize the games 1 year ago, and over the first year we really tried to tackle the cost of the games concept. And yesterday at the executive board of the IOC, they voted for this new concept where we could save one new site, where we could optimize the concept by, again, having the same principles in mind. First, control the budget. Second, having the best experience for athletes and spectators. And third, leaving a legacy. So for instance, when we imagine the way to organize swimming, we try to really have in mind that what is the best model in terms of temporary venue or permanent venue to leave a strong legacy for the host territory at this place. So we have this in mind, and I believe that today the concept is stronger.
Concept is?
The games concept, having the different venues, because the IOC permitted us to improve it thanks to the new norm. And that's something we will continue to challenge over the next the coming 6 years, because if there are new opportunities coming, we will be able to benefit from those opportunities.
What was your reaction when you heard that two cities had been awarded the opportunity to host the games at the same time?
Well, you know, I like the competition. Huh? I'm a former athlete, so I like very much the competition with the friends from LA, and I think it was a fantastic scenario for the IOC to have those two cities competing together, and I think now there is a great opportunity also to work together. Those two great cities to really implement a new way of delivering the games, trying to optimize things in terms of construction of the village for the athletes. We have different way to in terms of digital and how we will really tackle new way of engaging the population. I think this is fantastic opportunity for us to have this partnership with LA, and we work with them, and I hope that the games will be stronger thanks to this partnership.
Well, you have that competition, but you have that partnership. What you have in common is that you are both cities that have hosted the games before and have much of the infrastructure in place. The new norms, do you think that will allow for a newer nation, a developing nation, a nation that doesn't have the infrastructure to come in and host the games? Or actually, will it be down to the more experienced cities?
Again, I think we should keep this flexibility. I think at this time, this is important for the Olympic movement maybe to change a little bit, and those two editions of the games with Paris and LA are with this strategy in mind, and that's great for the movement, because I think for the general population it's a good way to demonstrate that it's not only building infrastructures that you deserve the right to organize the games, but maybe for the future we will come back to a new model. And that's the good part of it with the new norm, that we keep flexibility and really put the platform, this magic platform, at the service of a city which has a real vision in mind.
One worry of our previous panel was that people say they're going to do something, they are awarded the games, and then they sort of get caught in those headlights and just think, oh, we want everything shiny and new. There's no risk of Paris doing that?
This is really important that we kept this credibility. And there is a list of commitments made during the bidding phase. And I want to engage my credibility in this world, and you can count on the fact that Paris 2024 will be at the level of the promises we made during the bid phase, and also I think again we have to remain open to any opportunity that might arrive.
Overall, you're just going to keep it classy, aren't you, Tony? Thank you very much, Tony Estanguet, for sharing your thoughts this afternoon. We look forward to Paris 2024. Bonne chance.
Merci.
Thank you. Merci. Continue the conversation online. I'm going to try and not fall off this stool. Thank you very much for joining us. Yes, my... St-